U.S. airstrikes in Yemen have killed al-Qaeda chief Nasir al-Wuhayshi, removing the leader of its offshoot in the Arabian Peninsula. The White House announced that news today, and the militant group confirmed it in a video statement posted online. Wuhayshi was known as al-Qaeda's charismatic second-in-command and a close associate of Osama bin Laden in the years leading up to the 9/11 attacks. Earlier today, Judy spoke with retired Marine General John Allen, the president's point person for the coalition fighting the Islamic State, about the strike on the rival militant group.
It's a blow to al-Qaeda as the number two in al-Qaeda. It just continues to reinforce the point that al-Qaeda leadership will be at risk no matter where they are on the planet, that the United States is going to hunt you down and we're going to deal with you.
Judy's complete interview with General Allen will run later in the broadcast. For more details of the slain al-Qaeda leader, I spoke earlier with former Deputy National Security Advisor for Combating Terrorism, Juan Zarate. Welcome back, Juan Zarate.
Thank you, Gwen.
So what does the death of Nasir al-Wuhayshi tell us about the health of al-Qaeda?
Well, al-Qaeda remains under pressure, and it's having a tough time remaining the vanguard of the global violent extremist movement, especially with the challenges coming from the Islamic State. Wuhayshi was one of the senior most and long-standing leaders of al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda's number two worldwide was leading al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. And so this is a significant blow. That said, al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula itself is much stronger than it has been, has more manpower, more funds, has established a safe haven in eastern Yemen, controlling a city called Mukalla. They've even robbed banks there. And so al-Qaeda in some ways still presents a threat, but the removal of Wuhayshi, who presents an element of connectivity for the group globally, is really a blow to the attempts by al-Qaeda to remain the vanguard of this global movement.
Al-Qaeda is so Hydra-headed, and of course we've seen the rise separately of ISIS in recent years. Does this mean, and there have been a string of attacks which seem to have taken out people who are either number one or two in different areas of the region, does this mean that al-Qaeda is on its way out, is on its heels, or is that too much to hope for?
I think it's too much to hope for. Unfortunately, this is a movement that has metastasized around the world. And so you've had this group in Yemen, al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, affiliates in North Africa and East Africa, a movement that has inspired others to attack. Keep in mind that al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula took credit for the Charlie Hebdo, the Paris attacks. Right. And so in some ways, the ideology itself has spawned this global movement. And it's not good enough now, I think, at this stage to simply remove a leader, although he has been incredibly important and significant. And so we're still going to see a threat from this group as it adapts to the pressure.
Does this success mean that we have sources from within who are helping us to find these leaders?
It's a great question, Gwen, because the U.S. has actually had to vacate its presence in Yemen. It's left the embassy. The military presence is no longer there. Our allies on the ground have been fighting other fights amid the civil war and chaos in Yemen. But it does suggest we continue to have eyes and ears that are allowing us to target these kinds of individuals. And as the White House has said, they're going to take strikes unilaterally against those that are plotting against the U.S., and Wuhayshi obviously fit that bill.
And in the same degree that when Osama bin Laden was taken out, there were others who rose to replace him. Is that the case here as well?
Absolutely. The successor in waiting has been Qasem al-Rimi, the militant commander of AQAP. And so AQAP, unfortunately, is not going to really miss a beat, and they're going to remain focused not just on establishing a safe haven in Yemen, but also attacking the West. And I think that's the reality of a movement that has endured these kinds of decapitations over time. They know that the succession will come. It'll be interesting, though, Gwen, to see who becomes the al-Qaeda deputy globally. We haven't heard from Ayman al-Zawahiri yet. That will be an announcement that we need to watch.
Juan Zarate, as always, thank you very much.
Thank you, Gwen.
As we just mentioned, the killing of the al-Qaeda leader in Yemen comes against a backdrop of heavy fighting in the country since March that has claimed thousands of lives. Today, representatives for the Houthi rebel delegation finally arrived for UN-led peace talks in Geneva, but rival factions refused to sit in the same room. The UN is hoping to at least establish a ceasefire when Ramadan begins later this week. Journalist Jane Ferguson is in Yemen on assignment for the NewsHour. She told us earlier today that many on the ground aren't counting on a diplomatic breakthrough.
Every day and night, the sound of airstrikes and anti-aircraft gunfire can be heard across Sana'a. Neither side wants to be seen to be backing down, and several months of violence has hardened each side's position. In the meantime, life for Yemenis is a constant struggle. A Saudi-imposed blockade on the country has made essentials scarce. Families are living on small supplies of rationed water. People sit in their cars for several days as they wait in line for gas. And hospitals say they are running out of essential supplies. Yemen has long been the poorest country in the Middle East, but this recent crisis is creating a humanitarian disaster worse than ever before.
You can watch Jane Ferguson's full report from Yemen on the NewsHour later this week. Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas announced that the government he formed with rival Hamas last year will dissolve. This news comes in the wake of last year's war in Gaza and frustrations over political power sharing there.